Let's continue. Now for the general discussion session, and to explain the concept a bit, the idea is to truly have a very democratic format, which means that the usual division of labor between, you know, well, the expert lecturers on the one hand, and the more or less passive audience, which at maybe poses a question or two with a strict limit on, you know, no follow-up questions and very, very concise formulations. So we will have none of that. We'll try to cancel that out as far as possible. Insofar as the idea is, the risk, of course, is cacophony. But we believe that if this format works, then that the collective, the process of you know, of our collective intelligence will maybe give more interesting results than the usual unidirectional format of Q&As. Having said that, of course, initially and for much of the time, most of the questions or comments will be directed at the lecturers. That this is not something we're trying to prohibit, but it is simply to say that it is also legitimate for other participants here, discutants, members of the audience, to also raise their own concerns or comments, or even comment on something someone else, another participant in the discussion has said, who is not necessarily one of the lecturers. So very broadly, this is the idea. These are the, it entails its a certain risks, but for now it has always worked much better than one might have expected. So we hope that the same will be the case today. Having said that, we can now start. So also, of course, if there are any questions or comments on either of the lectures we heard earlier, for which there was no time, or if you want to ask questions to the two lecturers, maybe to both of them, all of that is very legitimate and welcome.
So I can start. Question for both of you in your different technology that you present. You already addressed this question of not coherent programs and inconsistencies in especially economic programs and policies of different parties. Jan was talking about this question, is it suitable pluralism or is it just a list of inconsistencies? You also in your topology mentioned these different aspects of social economic programs like different parties, some kind, if you can call it neoliberal, some are social protectionist, and they are really sometimes really mishmash in a sense, but is it this kind of inconsistency in economic programs somehow there is this so-called conscious response to the what they see as a class structure society or the way how their electoral strategy is addressing different different classes, so they. Let's say they know, okay, if we give this kind of social program, we can integrate some part of the working class, or if this will integrate other this faction of, I don't know, small bourgeoisie or something like that. Do you think it's a part of some kind of strategy that, in a broader sense, it not only includes, but have a class perspective in some kind of, class dimension in some kind of economic perspective, or is it just, and it's just not so conscious reaction to the policies that are being implemented by the establishment parties, or some reaction to the competition, so-called competition from the left. How do you see these inconsistent economic policies and programs from their perspective, or from the perspective of how these parties scan the electoral body or the class differences?
I would say that in a certain way it reflects the need to construct let's say, something like social coalitions. I mean, with the bourgeoisie only, you will never win an election. I would say that's impossible. And, for example, if we compare Fidesz and PiS, I would say, first of all, Fidesz has a narrower class perspective than PiS has, from my point of view. It is much more clearly targeted, on the one hand, I mean, to certain groups of the domestic capital, but I mean, that's very small. But secondly, mainly to the parts of the middle class, middle strata, especially the upper middle strata. So there, some of their concerns were very obviously addressed. In economic policy, conversion of the foreign exchange loans, for example. Question of family benefits related to tax rebates, so thus to income. Flat tax, so that means tax relief for the upper middle class as well. On the other hand, I would say they are discouraging the poorer parts of the population even to go to the elections. They even had, once they tried to introduce an electoral law that would have required the voters to register beforehand. And of course, I mean, it's obvious who would not have registered. Yeah, that was declared unconstitutional. And in addition, I would say, I mean, the trade union movement in Hungary has not been very assertive. And in the case of Poland, I'd say that first of all, Platforma Obywatelska, the national liberal party, rather addressed the concerns of the urban upper middle classes anyway. So I mean, that terrain was occupied. Secondly, though the crisis was not so deep in Poland, it did have effects on the public perception of the whole transformation process, becoming more critical. And though, I mean, the degree of organization of the trade unions in Poland has declined very significantly, nevertheless, I would say trade unions are more assertive in the case of Poland. And PiS historically, or the national conservative current, historically is linked to the trade union movement. So it is a different situation as well, different environment. And they have addressed certain social concerns, not only of the middle strata, but in some respects for other social classes as well. And so far, I would say it is a more encompassing, in a certain way, a more encompassing project. And the decisions are, I mean, that's very difficult to say, but I think it certainly has a conscious element, and to some extent I think the changing context as well explain certain types of positioning and heterogeneous social base, I mean, in a certain way has to be reflected in a not really coherent program from my point of view. So for them the question is whether it works practically or not, you know, whether it is a coherent ideological concept. I would say that's less, in certain way, less important.
Pretty much agree on this.
If there is a strategy at all, I'd say it's the vote-seeking strategy, which makes them most flexible, not only in the economic field, but in all other fields too, to collect as much votes as possible. But for example, in the case of the Alternative for Germany, the Alternative für Deutschland, which started off with a foundation crew of professors of a neoconservative, neoliberal orientation, and their first program had nothing to do with any class perspective towards any lower or middle classes. It was just more or less a regular offer of an alternative neoliberal program. But they did recognize soon that they could catch votes when they integrate some demands like this minimum wage thing I mentioned and so on to get more votes. On the one hand, on the other hand, this conflict I was outlining between this so-called folkish wing and the neoliberal wing also has much to do with the question of party versus movement. There's this Björn Höcke I was talking about, who's saying explicitly, the party is nothing, the movement is everything. And he was organizing over months manifestations in a almost Nazi style in Erfurt, which is the capital of Thuringia, where he was holding speeches week after week with an audience of, I don't know, 3,000-4,000 people at high time, at the high peak of the so-called Pegida movement. You've probably heard the patriotic Europeans against Islamization, something like this. And that was kind of a strategic move towards the so-called left behinds, towards the not really lower class, but middle classes under pressure, yeah, which are fearing to lose more and more, and now are searching for an old, we have to say, an old identitarian offer, yeah, which is then the nationalism. But yeah, I don't see a class project behind this up to now, neither. Yeah.
We had Luca and then Nicola.
Actually, I get two questions, but they got the answer to my first question about, are there any empirical research which social groups or which professions vote for those parties? So I will go on my second question. We all know that there are regional differences in Germany about the vote share of AfD, you know, that they get much more votes on the east than on the west. So my question is, what is your explanation of this phenomenon? And are there the similar things in the UK and in France?
I would say the German case has some specificities.
And that is linked to the unification process. I mean, the unification process, I mean, it was called Anschluss, and it was, I mean, the GDR was followed by the Federal Republic of Germany. And the German, West German legislation was immediately applied. And the East German industry was taken over, and to a large extent, it was liquidated. And in addition, I mean, the top cadres changed, they were replaced by West Germans. So, I mean, when the expectation was, I mean, with the change, there would be a certain type of upward mobility. I mean, the upward mobility wasn't there because, I mean, the top positions were occupied by the, or many of them, yeah, many of them were occupied by the West Germans, yeah, in the state administration, in the universities, many cases in the companies, in the banks as well. Yeah? So I would say many of the East Germans felt as second class citizens. Yeah? So they declared that we are Germans, but I mean, the top positions was not for them. And in a certain way, I would say the second class Germans have now voted of what they perceive the third class Germans. That is the Germans with migrant background. Yeah? So that, and that I would see a certain specific element in the German election result. And this völkische element is, I would say, it tends to be stronger in the East than in the West. What we can see in many cases of the rather far right-wing parties that they are stronger in the rural and peri-urban areas, rather than in the capital cities and the big metropolitan areas. Yeah? So I think that is an almost general pattern. Yeah? At times they are stronger in the degraded former industrial areas as well. Yeah? And that's, I think that's more complicated to explain. What we can see that in many of the rural and peri-urban areas, much of the public infrastructure, etc., has disappeared. Yeah? And in so far, it might be seen partially as a revolt of being left behind in those issues not being addressed anymore by the mainstream parties. Secondly, maybe something like bourgeois hegemony is weaker where the bourgeoisie is all more or less absent, because I mean in the peri-urban areas or rural areas it is a pity bourgeoisie that it's locally present, but I mean the bourgeoisie as such not so much. And for example in Lower Austria, that is not the FPÖ that is very strong, but the ÖVP has very strong clientelist links. Almost feudal type of links. And that is, I would say that is linked to a particular political culture in that area. It is different in Tyrolia, but in certain parts of the country, it is like that. And all the debates of the positive effects of internationalization and globalization, I mean, in the rural areas, I mean, the effects are not usually not seen. So I mean, they are not, I would say, often not even present in the discourse of much of the liberal and conservative parties. And for example, the ÖVP, the traditional Christian Democrat party in Austria that has moved considerably to the right. I mean, what they did defend has been the interest of the peasants. Yes, but I mean, it's a very small minority in the rural areas. But for the rural areas as such, I would say no concept. So, I mean, they have neglected their former or partially still present electorate. And I mean, the people perceive that and they look for another right-wing alternative. And the other right-wing alternative, as you can imagine, is the FPÖ. Huh? So that would be at least an attempt to explain it a bit.
You were asking for if there were studies concerning the professional representation. Haven't in mind any in specific, but I do think that concerning the professions, it's a pretty balanced vote, which makes the AfD pretty much a so-called Volkspartei. A people's party because of this balance. I think there is a relative clear break in the age cohorts voting for them, and there's especially the ages of I think between 40 and 60. There are some younger ones, and then the age of the 40s to 60s voting overrepresentatively the AfD, which is the generation of the Wende, of the 89th generation. Those who were like ready with school, ready with professional formation. And then there started capitalism, and they were like betrayed more or less, or felt betrayed more or less. Others say this is the generation of Hoyerswerda and Rostock. Those are two locations in Germany where racist riots in the beginning of the 90s against asylum homes and the so-called guest workers were taking place.
And those are the ones now who are coming of age and having another offer than the NPD, for example, to vote for. One thing about this unbalance between East and West, you have to consider it cautiously, I think, because yes, the percentage representation in the East is much more, is much higher than in the West, but the East, or especially the rural parts of the East, are depopulated over the last 20-25 years, meaning that the 25% the AfD got in Saxony or in Sachsen-Anhalt, mm-hmm. which is another region, in total numbers are not so much like for are not so many people as for example the 10 or 12% they got in Baden-Württemberg or in Bavaria. Yeah, so the total numbers voting for the AfD in parts of the Western Germany are even higher than. But yeah, as Joachim said, an important part is that especially the rural areas of the eastern part of Germany are totally deindustrialized since the 90s, depopulated, and there's a total lack of any kind of bourgeois civil society. And there's no infrastructure anymore. And in the last two and a half decades, this was homeland to the NPD. Yeah? The NPD was represented in for some years in three of the regional parliaments. And they were like preparing already the field. They are now they're now like crying that the AfD took over, but we always had this this far right representation then for since the 90s.
Yeah. We have Nikola and Simonovich.
Yeah, so this is not so much a question, more a comment on what Marco was asking about the ideological inconsistencies of the far right. And for me, a very interesting example is the French example. As Jan already mentioned before, so they started as a very far right, a bit nostalgic about French colonies, but at the same time, like strongly neoliberal party. And then starting in the 90s, they have this turn towards kind of social demagoguery and generally this protectionist, welfare chauvinist turn. And I mean, this turn escalated very much in the last years, especially before the last presidential elections. But it's also, I mean, this turn didn't come, this is not an accident that they had this trajectory. This turn didn't come from their internal discussions in which they concluded, oh, if we want to be a better far rightist, we have to turn to social issues. This was actually a very very well thought through strategy of taking over the former electorate of the Communist Party that was for that had for whole Cold War period basically was the third or second or first sometimes biggest political party in France, and which started its slow collapse after the end of the Cold War. And that's exactly why, of course, we always think and talk about Front National as a far-right party, but in every day, in their every statement, they explicitly state, we are neither far, we are neither right nor left. They clearly differentiate themselves from the right. They always try to present themselves as a social party, with a very clear wink or hint towards the former electorate of the Communist Party, especially in the north, in the mining towns and former industrial towns, which was actually a successful strategy. And they calculated that it could have been a victorious strategy in this last presidential elections, but was something stopped by this by presenting a leftist alternative, like this patriotic Republican leftist alternative to the social demagoguery of the Front National. But I mean, the point is that when asking about their ideological consistency, it seems that far right is basically similar to other bourgeois parties. These are electoral strategies that are fought through and organized by the same type of educated PR young experts from the best university that or from the best national university that basically organize the electoral strategy of other bourgeois parties. So. Okay.
Does anyone want to comment on this? Then Sinke?
Yeah, when we were talking about Germany, I mean, it's not that the East was only like some kind of the nest already for the right wing or extreme right wing parties. It was also like a place where Die Linke had a huge number of votes, and they lost these votes in the previous elections. And when I discussed with people from Die Linke and Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung, their analysis showed that, for example, in the western part of Germany, they won votes from the younger population and higher educated population, and they lost working class, basically, and older people in the east. So I don't know, it's a question in a way. So is the left generally in Europe currently playing on the terrain that is already determined by the right wing organizations and right-wing ideology? Is it, you know, it's not, it is not in a way showing the answers to the lower classes, you know, what could be changed so their material situation could be changed. It is playing on the terrain of identity in some way. So it's more like right-wingers say we are against immigration and the left is saying yes, we are pro-immigration, but it is not in a way contesting material conditions of these people who are now voting for right-wingers because they feel threatened, not immediately by immigrants, but they are socially threatened. I mean, they are living poorly. So, you know, what can, from your perspective, left in Europe change in their, you know, in a way that they are contesting current situation and right-wing rise?
I think one problem is the lack of presence in the lower classes. Even, I mean, the political and physical presence. Yeah. And even, I would say, partial, at times, even a lack of even abstract or not so abstract knowledge of the living conditions. Yeah. And I mean, that makes it very difficult to address certain, even address certain issues in the correct or in a fitting way. Yeah? And I would say that even in some sectors of the left, there is even a certain disregard or arrogant attitudes against the lower classes, particularly on a cultural level. Yeah? And if you despise them in a certain way, I mean, they will never vote for you. I mean, that is quite obvious. And I think this is one of the problems. And I mean, one of the few organizations that to some extent still reaches those lower classes who vote, or the members of those who vote for the right wing, that is it, actually the trade unions. And so far I would say that the trade unions, because they still organizationally reach those persons and are perceived as nevertheless defending their interests, at least to some extent, I think that they at least have to play a relevant role. They cannot replace the left-wing parties. That is obvious because they have different functions. But nevertheless, I would say, in keeping a contact, in posing alternatives,
in a practical way, you know, in the activities of the trade unions, and let's say in a more programmatic way as well, I would see their role as being very important. You know? And what I'm saying now, I think that this is not only a question of the German left, it is a problem, and these issues of the left in other countries as well. And my personal impression is that the living realities and everyday life, I mean the social segmentation has become much deeper than it was in the 1960s or early 1970s. That is my impression, but that is a very subjective one. This is not a scientific statement, but that is my perception.
Yeah, you're right with your intervention that, of course, it's not just an identitarian or culturalist question, but yeah, it's a material question. And yeah, to start with, I think in some areas or in some regions, the party, the left, was already involved in governmental responsibility. And I do know it from the Berlin example, because I'm originally from there. They already proved more or less that they, under the given circumstances, they couldn't do really left politics. Yeah, what they were doing were more or less administrating the
budgetary constraint.
Yeah. As well as the others, and I think this is something that people remember. And then they just, not just recently, it's been going on for a longer time, but it's getting harsher now. There is a huge internal conflict in the left party, whether or not to play this terrain, which you are called determined by the left behinds, which are supposedly nowadays voting right wing. And there's there are some people in the left saying, yes, this is our natural reservoir, and we have to speak to them in a certain way, as nationally or as nationalistic as the right wingers do it. And I think this is a product of the lack of vision, a real lack of vision, because there ain't, on at least not on the party level, and the social movements are lacking stability and a long-term experience to formulate it. There ain't a left anti-capitalist project which is really something to catch the people with, because it can't be just a catching project, it has to be a social project, and we don't see it. So yeah, but this would be very abstract, yeah, but this would be my proposition. We have to work on this and win the people with this instead of going back to an electoral view of the people. They just have to vote us, and for this we are arguing against migrants and nationalistic as well. And when we are in government, then we would do anything different. Yeah. Sorry for the abstractness, but
Maybe I can follow up with a question on this one.
Since we touched on this now, and this is, I believe, part of the reason we are gathered here, decided to gather here, of course, it's not merely to analyze and describe what we are witnessing in terms of the rise of the right-wing, extreme right, and so forth, but for anyone positioning themselves on the left, this is also an immediately a political problem and a task, and an immediate political task. And then such questions, you have now touched on this. And I wanted to simply maybe inquire along something that has been already touched on, but which seems to me to make up something, maybe one very significant aspect of the problem from a left perspective of trying to understand and explain and counter the left of the right, the rise of right-wing forces. You have now said the left needs a project, and I would absolutely agree with this. Joachim earlier said that part of the left response should be to reframe the social question as a class question, not as a national question. And this would suggest, at least in that formulation, it was very abbreviated, and this was not the focus of your discussion, but to take it up and then to simply to complicate this and to say, okay, this would suggest the old left opposition between the authentic class interest on the one hand and the national as the mere ideological veil. But if we have historically, if there is one thing that the left had to learn the hard way, it is there are no pure class subjects. The national or the gender or racial questions, the identitarian questions, are not something separate from class. Class is an analytical concept which, once it is embodied, it is always already concrete in terms of gender, nation, race, whatever. What we have seen, of course, is for one, the right-wing forces historically have managed to use these fault lines, these identitarian divisions within the working class, to make it operational. You know, to rely on separations within the working class itself. As a very important instrument of managing capitalism and managing the working classes, which is, in terms of its political subjectivation, not a homogeneous political subject, but rather, as the left has often assumed, but the task of the left is precisely to make it one, you know? And then the question is, one additional question is, if we say, okay, class politics, but one important aspect of capitalism, of course, the left historically talks about the antagonism between the interests of capital and labor, which we know that this has very good analytical foundations in Marx and so on and so on. But also one important aspect is, of course, the antagonism of capitalism is also manifest in interclass conflicts and antagonisms, also within the working classes. And if you look at the most immediate existential level, to fight for one's class interests often means protecting, you know, to ensure one's own reproduction, you know, as a labor force within capitalism. It doesn't mean revolution normally. It means, you know, to fight for one's survival, because this is the structural imperative. To sell one's labor power is the prerequisite to successfully sell one's labor power, the prerequisite of reproduction in that type of society. And of course, you're doing it in competition with everyone else, with every other member of your class. And insofar, one could argue, of course, class interests, fighting for one's class interests, can take very many forms. It can take that the chauvinist or xenophobic or sexist or whatever you want to call it version is not necessarily in contradiction to this fundamental class interest of reproducing yourself as your labor power, to have a job. The problem, of course, is it is, the left would say, it is in the long term self-defeating, you know, because we are weakening the position of labor vis-a-vis capital as a whole. This may be true, but you don't survive, you know, in the long term. The long term contradiction of your position doesn't mean anything if there is no immediate strategy for survival that would be as plausible, at least as plausible or more plausible than the one the right wing is offering. And one can even imagine, I would say, you know, a class subject, a worker who used to, I don't know, in France, who used to vote for the Communist Party, who may understand, who may cynically, in that sense, intellectually understand that the Front National, in that sense, that it's not about, you know, immigrants or workers, but he may, because feel as a member of the lowest, you know, manual working class, most threatened by an influx of new labor power, which traditionally takes, you know, becomes a competitor. If it becomes a competitor on labor markets, then on that lowest level, and he may reason that it may not be the immigrant's fault, but he has to survive and to reproduce himself and his family. And he may feel very sorry, but he has to protect himself and his interest and his family. And that can mean then, you know, that immigrants should be kept out. And not out of deeply felt racism, that I'm not excluding it, but this is not even necessary. And this, so class interests, to make it short, is very complicated. I would say it's part of the problem. How does the class interest manifest itself? And I believe that what you answered is very important, that the left seems not to have a plausible project which would reply to these, to the class interests, not in terms of a long-term goal of socialist revolution or an utopian vision, but something that would immediately give a response that would put the emphasis on class solidarity as a viable strategy in everyday life, rather than accepting class divisions within the working class along national, ethnic, or gender, or other norms. So this is a big lump of subject matters, but just simply to, well, we have still an hour or so to complicate things maybe even a bit further.
I totally agree. I wasn't even quite clear what I meant with the left needs a project. Yeah, this is something we are like always like formulating. We need a project, but what is a project? You were operationalizing it a little bit more into in the combination of an immediate reply to needs with something more long-term orientated. That was my interpretation. I totally agree with you on there ain't such thing as a class subjectivity, and I believe we won't grasp this class subjectivity with these terms anymore. Yeah, we should, like, in our theoretical work, of course, we have to make clear there are still two classes in this world, which are like contradicting each other fundamentally. Yeah, the class of the proprietors and the class of the non-proprietors of the means of production. The class of the proprietors is getting really, really, really small, but because who actually is benefiting personally anymore of this mode of production? It's like really, really getting small. They're all like more, what's it called, fungierende Kapitalisten? More like functionary capitalists. For example, when we had the summer of migration, the so-called, like 2 summers or 2 years ago, there were made calculations for the German case that there were around 10, 11 million people more or less involved in a so-called welcome culture. Yeah? Meaning, there were so many people involved in really welcoming all those migrants at the train stations with a kind of a first aid intention. They are then giving them private language courses. They are taking partnerships for young migrants, whatever. What didn't work out then was to organize this movement more or less, yeah, which could have helped then, I think, to be part in the forming of a project, of an inclusionary project of this migrant movement, with loads of people in Germany which are not involved in any political, in any social movement whatsoever, just as a part of, and on a very exemplary basis. I think this didn't work out, but this could have been part of this, what I probably meant with project. On the class thing, getting back to the class thing, I'm always we all have these contradictions within ourselves of this neoliberal subjectivization. We all know this. Yeah? We all want to be the best
in the job, being parents, in the political organization, in everything. This is all very neoliberal, and we are forgetting, yeah, the social part of a kind of a grassrooting organization on an everyday life level. Again, what this means concretely, I don't know, but I think this is left out of consideration always.
Just to make it clarify, I didn't
try to suggest that there is no such thing as class subjectivity. I'm not so sure about that. What I would say is politically, class interests can take many divergent forms. Otherwise, the right wouldn't have a... The assumption would be that people are not so stupid as to vote against their own immediate interests, at least the immediate interests. You know, so the right wing has to appeal to some, at some level, to their material interests or their perception of their own material interests. But the question that the right can do so as well, just as well as the left, and tie the defense of social interests into different political projects is something that complicates this division between class interests on the one hand, as seemingly pure and transparent, and naturally leading towards a leftist political orientation, and you know, nationalism and sexism and everything else as a mere ideological guise. So the suggestion is merely that these things tend to, in effect, often be in a far more complex relations than a clean differentiation between class interests on the one hand and nationalist seduction, you know, like as mere or pure ideology would suggest. So,
I would say at least one word to that. Question class versus question of nation and migration. And then Social Democrat Trade Union Federation wrote a booklet on the New Vlaamse Alliantie, and it is called Looking Differently at the NVR. And I think looking differently at the FPÖ or Front National, I think that is useful. So to shift the focus, it does not make disappear the other issues, but to approach them from a different angle, yeah, and put them into a different context. Yeah. So it is not what I'm suggesting is not a frontal confrontation, but rather shifting how you discuss and frame certain issues from my point of view. Yeah. And so that's one thing. You referred to the refugees and in Germany 2 years ago. I mean, the German Prime Minister Merkel said, we can, yeah. But before she had said all the time, we cannot spend money on municipal infrastructure. We cannot spend money on schools. We cannot. Yeah. And I mean, obviously, I mean, it would have been the necessity to say, we can do this thing, but we can do the other things as well. And so far, to try to link improvements in certain areas to that question of the refugees, yeah? And she actively actually, when there were even some proposals from the Social Democrats, she said no, that we can't. Yeah? And so far, to practically try to link that, I think that it is necessary as well to actively deal with real existing problems, for example, in the education sector. In the case of Vienna, you have more children from a background where German is not the main language, not the mother language. And of course, you can do that as if the problem does not exist. And I mean, then it will continue. So you have active, I think in a certain way, you have to actively deal with certain issues that actually really are linked to migration, because they really do exist. Thirdly, I think that certain parts of the working class have disappeared from much of the center-left and left discourse. And the manual labor, I think it is almost not existing. And what is discussed is intellectual labor and things like that. And certain sectors almost have disappeared from the discourse and from thinking as well. And for example, the FPÖ and Front National explicitly in the programs address these groups, for example, regarding the education system, that more technical education should be improved. And so far, I would see the need to have a more differentiated view on the even the traditional working class, and how to address issues that are relevant to them. And insofar, I would say actively articulating different social sectors of the popular classes to at least try that. And of course, I mean, protection from my point of view can be a positive term as well, because it is a very legitimate, I would say it is a very legitimate concern. But the question is in how far this does include all, for example, all who live in a certain area, place, etc. Yeah? And whether it is only citizens and the non-citizens are excluded, for example, things like that.
I'm interested in hearing some of Jan's thesis that are more related towards activistic appliance of your thesis. Yeah. And that might be related to what Marco suggested, some of the possible answers against a currently dominant right discourse.
Okay, it's a broad question.
Just read your thesis.
Sorry, you're referring to
to the thesis yet that you did not present to the empty sheet.
Okay. No, those theses didn't have much to do with an activist view. Those were more referring to tries of explanation of the success of the electoral and social success of right-wing parties. But maybe to continue this what Joachim said, I'm not quite sure because I haven't experienced that, but in this article, the first part of my presentation was based on, I argued that amongst other things, that the electoral success is one thing. Yeah? When those right-wing parties start to really start to answer the social question in social practice, yeah? Which is something different than representing somebody in the parliament, meaning when they start to install social centers on a local level, yeah? When they start to really take care of the concerns of the people by starting the what's Bürgerwehr, the civil guards autonomously, and so on. This is the real dangerous point, I think. To this point, I'd say, yes, we have to start this as a left movement, more or less. And this could or should be like part of this project. And there are, I think, millions of projects, mostly leftist oriented on a self-organizational grassroots level. Yeah, they're like counseling people how to manage to go to the social service department and whatever. But what's still lacking is kind of a political perspective is this, that it is like framed politically what's happening socially there. Again, very abstract, sorry. But I think we should think further in this direction to counter the dangerous tendencies proposed by or posed by right-wing
activists. Or to give it, because I brought the example of rural areas in eastern Germany. I have family there in the very brown, brown is the chiffre for Nazi, because of the brown skirts of the SA, in a very brown part of eastern Germany. What happens there in this process of deindustrialization, of depopulization, in villages, I'd say, who have lesser than, I don't know, 5,000-6,000 people inhabitants, yeah, there ain't such thing as a youth club anymore. Yeah? There used to be youth clubs organized by the town or the village, but in the smaller ones, there ain't anything like that. What Nazis do, they offer something like this, with their cultural offers of music, of football, soccer, whatever. So we have a structure of material social offers, socializing whole generations. Yeah? At the same time, everybody who has, sorry, this is not meant chauvinistic, but everybody who has some intelligence leaves the rural areas, goes to the next big city, yeah, to study whatever. Those are, in the end, those are the people who could change this at this level, but they are leaving. Yeah? So we are leaving the whole field, or one of the fields for this left project. So I'm not arguing that we should all go to the rural areas now, but this is part of the problem, of course.
So it is entirely legitimate to, for those who have already participated
Raise their, to have a second or third contribution?
Well, maybe to follow up on this, because there is a question, something Joachim has already mentioned, that there is a form of cultural racism towards the lower classes, which even prevalent on the left, which of course is the ironic thing being that the left historically is supposed to be, you know, the political organ of the masses. And also, so, but there is this, of course, this, or how could you call it, an obvious shift of that people who are generally left-wing tend to be more and more higher education and of very urban cultural preferences. And you're also referring now to the same predicament, basically, that some people are, of course, if we add to this very immediate material questions we have, you have also mentioned, but we have raised before. There's also this question of, the question of representation. Or if we remember that even the left fell victim to this idealized globalization discourse in terms of at least an aspect of it, like immaterial labor, which was something like the spontaneous, I don't know, post-operaism as becoming some sort of spontaneous leftist ideology to accompany globalization and all of these post-Cold War, you know, tendencies. And of course, there was this futuristic leap forward in terms of the expectation of that, where the left accepted more or less that the classical class class divisions were obsolete now, and or that the new classes are the new class subjects, political subjects like precariat or whatnot, and that this shifting of the discursive intellectual focus on something which was an emergent phenomenon, if it was that at all, or something in part maybe even a leftist intellectual projection, or something which was the result of the projection of an intellectual trend. What was ignored was that you still had this the old manual working class that present and either pushed into unemployment or put themselves in a very socially endangered economic sphere.
proposition. And then the question becomes precisely this: to what extent to re-establish communication and not allow this whole demographic to be to allow the monopoly of political representation of this whole demography to leave it to the right wing, which seems to be happening now effectively, which you suggest with the example of Eastern German rural areas, as well as in some, and we all know the, especially in Germany, the discussion about Erich Bohn's book and the question of how the traditional left-wing parties, social democrats and communists, deserted basically the traditional working classes or the lower classes, and that this is a very important aspect of understanding the rise of the Front National.
Where you mentioned an aspect that is maybe important as well, but you only mentioned it indirectly.
For me, I mean, this post-operaist, I mean, for me, Negri is something like a left-wing Hayekian. Yeah? So it's a spontaneous order. Yeah? And very much anti-etatist, anti-organization, and I think that this had a certain impact or reflected certain tendencies on the left as well. That is the lack of organization, the neglection of questions of organization. And I mean, the right at times it is well organized. It has an organizational structure. As far as the Fidesz and peace are concerned, I would say they really have a strategy and elaborated a strategy over many years, yeah? And produced the organizational structures as well that at least were able to carry that out, yeah? And with a certain presence. I would say the organizational question, apart from all the questions we have raised, I mean, that is an issue, from my point of view, that is an issue as well. And I mean, for example, peace seems to be almost a cater party. In order to get into the party, I mean, you need a recommendation by other party members, otherwise you are not even admitted to the party. So it is, in a certain way, a relatively well-organized and coherent force. We were discussing the SNS, Serbian SNS in the morning and the clientelist policy. So maybe the Serbian SNS is more of a mass party because it is so easy to join the party and it is a capilla, in a certain way, a capilla party. So I mean, there might be different organizational models in order to reach into society. But nevertheless, I would say for the left, the organizational question is as well important. And in addition, I would say to reach certain things and to establish a certain presence, local presence, and later national presence, it takes a long time. It takes years. And so far, unfortunately, it needs a lot of patience. So until certain endeavors take fruit, I mean, it is many years of, at times not very visible, not very visible work before that. And I think this is one of the weaknesses of the left as well. And my impression is, I mean, you mentioned the question of the advisors, PR advisors to the right-wing parties, but my impression is that at times they don't have only PR advisors, they do have them as well, obviously, yes. But they have political caterers as well, who can be advised. Mm-hmm. And so far, building political structures, I think that is a necessity for the left as well. And in some areas, I mean, the left, usually in the smaller, in the peri-urban areas and rural areas, very often it is practically not very present. And mainly it is in the urban centers, and so far the urban centers, for practical reasons, need to be the starting point. But I mean, it is important to get over time beyond the starting point, geographic one.
I have really no answer to your question because I'm not so much into this Hartian, Negrian, immaterial labor or multitude thing. But I just want to comment a small thing or make a small comment on what you said about the book or of Didier Ribon. Because in the German, I don't know if it's here the same, but in the German context, this book was pretty much or was part of a new start of a debate of new class politics. Now everybody is talking about the new class politics we have to make. Until now, there I haven't read a text who really elaborated what is this new class. And what could be the politics, but yeah, we are talking about, or we are discussing here as well, the same subject. But I think the main point Eribon made was not only, we forgot the class politics during the last 40 years, and so we left the lower and middle classes and the manual working classes, the male white working class to the right. But what he was, I think, exemplifying with his own biography was the parallel development of identitarian postmodern politics, which I would honor as one of the successes of the aftermath of the 68 movement, that a left movement overcame the classical class orientation and took in new forms or new clavages and respectively new forms of politics called the new social movements. And what's he saying now? I left, or my generation left this the class politics aside in favor of this identitarian politics. I'd say, okay, the challenge now is not to forget both, but to reintegrate them again. Yeah, or as a, I don't know if you know Thomas Seibert, the German philosopher. Philosopher, political activist, saw the quality of 68 exactly in going together the artist's critique of social circumstances with the social critique of the class conditions. And I think this is a challenge of the time to reintegrate this, and maybe we are still lacking an interpretation of the modes of production at the state of the art. Yeah, what is it now? Yeah, it's capitalist, of course. But what's the actual point of the contemporary mode? And respectively, we are lacking an interpretation of what does this make with the class relations or the how Klassenzusammensetzung, the composition of the class, right?
But I would say what the right really is changing, that is a mode of reproduction, because I mean it's quite obvious that part of the right-wing agenda is that many more of the reproductive activities should be shifted back into the family, that is to the women, in basic terms. Yes, I would say that is an important element as well. It is not a minor one. And in so far, these gender issues, I would not say that it can be reduced to identity issues. It has a very deep material dimension from my point of view. And it is very closely linked to social issues, like, I mean, how reproduction work in health, in education, in old age care is done
on the one hand, and secondly, we can see that, I mean, that is one of the sectors where there have been labor struggles. I mean, here in the region, in how many countries, I mean, there have been strikes and actions by the nurses because, I mean, they are so drastically underpaid. Health sector is a big problem, both the working conditions and, I mean, the results, I mean, it's very bad, and I mean, it is not only a topic of the wages, a topic as well of the quality of the care work, how it is organized, which norms are applied. Another sector where we have seen labor struggles as well is education system in many countries of the region as well, and it is mainly female labor as well. So I would say this is one of the areas, I mean, where there actually there are even struggles. There are organizations, there are struggles, and it is an issue. And it is one of the sectors, or that is sectors that are under attack by the far right, or at least the far right does not have an answer either. You know? So, for example, in Hungary, yes, Fidesz has been challenged by the teachers. Peace has been challenged by the medical personnel. You know? And I think we should keep that dimension in mind as well. And there is even political activity there where it is possible to relate to. You know? And for building alliances, I think that that is a very important question of class and gender can be not only thought together, but I mean bound together in practical activities.
Just to follow up, since there are no additional
comments, but because I think this is something you mentioned, artistic critique at the 68, of course, as something an important aspect of achievements of the left in the 20th century and the second half. I believe we can agree on that, but we also have to acknowledge that this type of artistic critique of capitalism, as Poltanski and Schapiello and some others have pointed out, has to some extent become an integral part of neoliberal discourse and hegemony. And this may be already maybe part, insofar as the left has allowed itself to be predominantly that this 68 or post 68 type of left, with the initial emphasis on. Not to go now into the concrete historical reasons for pointing out that, well, then the legitimate argument then was, well, class does not resolve everything. We can see that by the opportunism of the labor unions. We can see that repression along gender and sexual identity lines is still prevalent. It is not necessarily something that can be subsumed under class politics in the terms of the old left. And these were legitimate points of critique, but insofar as the left has focused on that aspect, that 68 aspect or post 68 aspect or artistic critique, it has navigated itself to a position where it is perceived as the spokespeople of sexual minorities or minorities in general, and something of a type of elitist discourse insofar as it seems to exclude or to construct the great enemy, like the white heterosexual male. If that's maybe more an American context, but insofar as ironically, if that is the great boogeyman, the question of class, if that is reintroduced, would also changes the picture. I mean. Like there is no, just as there is no homogenic or abstract class subject, it's already male or female, it is gendered, it is sexualized, it has a sexual identity, it has a certain type of cultural background and identity. So these two things, I believe, cannot be separated. But also there is no such thing as an abstract white male, he's always already, or abstract white woman, they're always already class subjects, I mean, however way you turn it, and if the contribution of the post-68 left or altruistic critique has been to point out that subjects are always already more or more complex than mere class subjects, if the question of class subjectivity is left out, then you the leftist project can become one which is very hard to distinguish between this neoliberal which can have very difficult will have difficulties defending itself against neoliberal appropriations. Or being perceived by the working classes, by many working classes, as merely an expression of an elitist politics. So this is not a solution, but simply to say that yes, precisely, we always have to think class in its concrete embodiments, which is all, are always already, as Joachim also points out, you cannot separate gender from class, the question of nationality from class, insofar as labor markets are still national labor markets. As long as that is a reality, that becomes a very strong and important point of real division within the working classes, which the left has to have, not only to take analytically account of, but also to try to find concrete strategies to cope with.
I have a question about how do you, since predict the way that AfD will function in German parliament, especially this Jamaica coalition turns out to govern the country, in the sense that Jan mentioned this, okay, in one, you can have this parliamentary representation of some people and some ideas, and on the other hand, the more dangerous one that you can have this social implementation in material sense of these movements. What do you think that, you know, what's the next so-called, okay, we saw the quote from Golan, we hunt the government, but how do you think they will somehow position themselves in terms, okay, now the SPD will be also the opposition? What do you think is that new, let's say, parliamentary tactics or orientation? Because now they're in national parliament, what do you expect from them?
Haven't thought so much about this yet. Yeah, on the first hand, the opposition probably will be split, and out of good reasons, as part of the left, or as the left, we will probably experience a reorientation of the social democracy, trying to involve more in extra parliamentary movements and politics. Or at least trying to refer much more to them, I suppose. But what I said earlier, with this so-called real politics wing who just recently left, I think there are still there's still a huge amount of functionaries in this party who actually want to make real politics and not be fundamental opposition, like this Höcke wing I was talking about. And for example, I think in Saxony there are elections, not the next, but the year to come after, and polls are already showing that it's most probable that they will be the junior partner, which is not junior then, but like maybe even to the CDU in a possible coalition. And if this is kind of a realistic goal, of course it will moderate a certain wing working towards this. In the end, at first sight, as an anti-fascist activist, I'm fearing all the infrastructure and the money and the information they'll get now institutionally. So this is my first concern. I haven't thought so much about now how they're going to act in the parliament itself.
But that's also part of the question not only parliament but also the extraparliamentary activity. Yeah.
Well, there was, for example, the experience of this cordon sanitaire, which all the French parties put towards the Front National. I think this experience showed that a political cordon sanitaire is nothing worse if there isn't a social one as well, yeah, on an everyday level. So combined with the electoral system of France, which is different from the German one, for a long time you could think, okay, they are not so dangerous because they were underrepresented for a long time. Now we saw in the last presidential elections there were like 11, 12 million people or something voting for Marine Le Pen. one of the first things which the old government still changed was, for example, and I think they did this with a good reason, there's a tradition of the so-called elderly president of the parliament, of the Bundestag, which used to be the function for the real, the oldest person, the oldest deputy by age. And they changed it just before the elections to the oldest deputy by mandate, saying so the oldest one or the long who's been the longest one in the parliament,
longest serving member of parliament.
And out of that reason, actually, the oldest by age now is an AfD deputy, but the oldest by mandate is I think from the CDU. So they managed to politically segregate them for just one action. This is the elder president. Well, his main function is to hold the first speech in a legislature. This, I think, this is it already. But yeah, they are trying, or at least I interpret it as still trying not to talk too much with them, but. Well, I don't know. What do you say?
I would say, I mean, by the presence of the parliament, that we get a certain type of legitimacy that did not have before.
I would say that's the first thing. Secondly, I would expect the ambiguity of the party between the more extreme right wing and the less extreme forces. It will simply continue because it is even convenient for both wings. This ambiguity to continue. And they have some cadres in the national parliament that I experienced because they had important functions for the Christian Democrats. And so far, I would say they even have a certain expertise. And of course, now the expertise will increase. Yeah? So through the institutionalization, this certainly will be an effect. To some extent, I mean, and they will have the monopoly of the right-wing opposition. Yeah, so a certain type of opposition, they have the monopoly because, I mean, the rest of the opposition will be to the left. That is a new situation, new constellation for Germany. And we will see how the Christian Democrats, CDU, CSU, will react. And to some extent, I would say it depends as well how the Christian Democrats are able to deal with the situation or not able to deal with the situation. That's very difficult to first of all to predict. And my impression is that the Christian Democrats, I mean the majority, rather wants to keep them out, and they hope or they wish to get them out of the parliament again. That is my guess. Mm? At least they wish. But others, from my point of view, a minority, presently certainly a minority. Current, for them, I mean, I would say making a coalition or cooperation is not out of question. And at times, I mean, that even surfaces. But at the moment, I would say it's still a minority. Mm? And how that will work out, unfortunately, we will have to see. Yeah? We'll have to see.
I just got a point on this. Yeah. What especially CDU, CSU, but the social democracy as well, did in the last 4 years of the existence of the AfD to counter this right-wing force was to integrate some of their contents. Yeah. So especially the CSU, I was talking about earlier, this Horst Seehofer as a chairman, they were laying out so right. I mean, they are already right-wing of origin, but they were laying out even further. Topics like the so-called upper limit for immigration, yeah, which we now in the coalition talks, they don't call it anymore upper limit, but it's actually an upper limit. But they're not discussing it with the AfD, they're discussing it with the Greens, yeah? With the FDP. So what the objective function in kind of a historical view already is a discursive shift to the right in the whole spectrum.
Not only in Germany, I mean, it's the same
yeah,
in
this,
other countries.
Yeah, right. And another point I got just on the legitimation issue, there is still space to still to make clear that they aren't an accepted party, although they are represented almost in, I think, in 13 or 14 regional parliaments in the European Parliament and now in the Federal Parliament. Right after the elections to the Bundestag in September, there were so many people on the streets. Yeah. I personally haven't seen them in the foremath of the election to counter those info points of the AfD and stuff. But well, there was a big amount of bourgeois Empörung.
Enragement
that there is such a party now represented in the parliament, and we're going to see if this will work out in the next time. They have their next party convention on the federal level at the beginning of December, and yeah, maybe if the population makes clear with I don't know how many 10,000 people. That they aren't accepted. This makes something. Yeah? If it doesn't work out, yeah, well, they will. Yeah, they're already and will be legitimized more and more, of course. And maybe another a friend of mine put it lastly in these words that. What happened in all of Europe during the last two or three decades, yeah, this right-wing shift, yeah, this growing of right-wing parties to their actual size, in the rest of Europe, they needed like 20, 30 years to do so. Yeah, and Germany like is the latecomer again, but then they did it in 4 or 5 years. So, and this is something I'm still thinking on, not to make too many historical, yeah, but.
One additional question, do you think that this closing of the front of indignation towards the AfD as a public gesture by all the other parties, that this may in fact also contribute to its anti-establishment aura in some, you know what I mean? I mean, of course, it's a tricky question. You don't want to legitimize them, but you also don't want to feed them the aura of the one only true anti-establishment party, you know? Because this was the first time I saw, when I saw these debates on German television, it was the first time you could see that even that most of the other parties were not focused polemically on the representative of Die Linke, you know, like you're the outsider, but it was the AfD guy or woman who was the outsider, and you know, suddenly even the Linke representative became respectable in terms of this broad anti
anti-AfD or anti-right-wing consensus, which of course it should, I mean, of course the left should be on that side of the front, but I'm just thinking about, is that maybe part of the appeal, you know, this of the truly establishment rebel for certain layers who are, you know, cynically disappointed by the whole political system as such, which seems to be, you know, always already not be, to be for the small guy or against the small guy. And now you have someone who speaks up, at least for the concerns of the small guy, and they, you know, and you have immediate, this immediate closing of the front and shutting them down and up, you know, because this spectacle of theatrical humiliation of the AfD representatives sometimes may, you know, it has a certain flavor to it, something like the indignation, it may, you know, seem like a form of, you know, also cultural racist indignation, you know, you're too vulgar, this is too ugly, this is, you know, I mean, does this in some sense reproduced too closely, you know, maybe the experience of class humiliation by certain members, I may be going too far, you know, but it's just simply speculatively that maybe that also is something that one should think about, that to emphasize maybe they are not really anti-establishment, rather than you know, maybe that's
they certainly will exploit every single bit of this, but so what? Right-wing politicians have always done this until the point they were in power. and I think we just have to live with this. So the result or the point could not be, in my eyes, to say, well, then another debate which is going on right now, talk with them. This is
talk in the sense of polemicize.
No, talk in the sense of cooperate.
No.
But it's a broad debate right now. For example, on the famous book fair in Frankfurt, there was an incident. There was an info point from an edition called Antaios. It's part of the New Right. Close links to the AfD nowadays too. And there was some anti-fascist, anti-racist protests. And this was kind of the start of a debate through all the feuilletons and all the important newspapers of, shall we now talk with the right or shall we not? Yeah. And my position is, if somebody is so anti-pluralist, in short, anti-human, that whatever he says or whatever she says, principally does not accept me and my viewpoint, I say, oh, why talk? So I'm choosing different methods than social protest and so on. Yeah, and so yeah, we simply have to live with this contradiction that of course it will, in certain layers of society, it's exactly this what happens. Ah, they are showing with the finger on them because they are saying this is establishment and stuff. Yeah, that's what I think too, but yeah, we have to live with that.
Actually, I would be a bit more maybe cautious than Jan. I mean, this open ostracization, every occasion, it always focuses the attention on that particular party, and I think that is not a very good idea, actually. They are a topic all the time. So I would say for routine operations, if they are sitting in parliament, they sit in parliament. If they are in the parliamentary committees, they sit in the committees like anybody else. But I mean, they should do so in an isolated way. But in certain rights, formal rights that they have, they can exercise. And I think that should not be questioned, because otherwise they can argue that they are victimized. You know? So far, I would say isolate, yes. But I mean, talking about them all the time, I think that's not a good idea, because and then they are always a topic, and that's not a good. That's what they want to be. They want to be seen as a special, in a certain way, special force, and in a certain way, in a very
unfortunate way, I mean, they get that status. Yeah? And to deal with that, I mean, it's a very complicated technical question. But I mean, even from the Austrian experience, I would say it would be wise to do it in a not so highly publicized way, and one should not forget the other forces that at times have positions that are not worlds apart as well.
I think maybe for the left, I mean, your article, the Kurzwechsel, if anything, showed to what extent these parties, despite the fact that they live off and feed off scandalization, you know, this is precisely the problem, like with gremlins, you know. I mean, they grow from that type of antagonism because this type of scandalization provides them with this aura of the rebel. But if you do a very sober analysis of their, you know, economic or social policies, you see, you're far from being this great oppositional force. In fact, what you're often enough, what you're advocating is the continuation of the same austerity policies, often with an even more vicious social Darwinist face and social chauvinist face, directed not only against immigrants, but against anyone who is weak or socially weak, you know. And maybe that would be the, I don't know, I mean, I'm not the one to suggest which tactic would be better, but maybe since the one of permanently scandalizing, you know, this like, this demonstration of indignation, you know, we shut, you know, since they feed off that to some extent, that in itself seems not to have been enough. I mean, I understand your sentiment. There is no no debate in terms of an inclusion into the discursive community of, you know, legitimate speakers. That is like the danger that you're fearing. But since they are already, you know, formally and institutionally there, you cannot, I mean, you can't avoid having to debate them. But if then, you know, maybe change the tactic towards pointing out that precisely they are not this great anti-establishment force, but quite, you know, in certain regards, quite the opposite, actually. I don't know.
I think you have to try to discuss points in the program that they don't want actively to discuss. I think that is really important. I mean, the FPÖ saying we are social Heimat, but Heimat is very difficult to translate. Domo, something like that. Domovina, Stranga, something like that. I mean, they are not social, they are antisocial. Yeah? And about Domovina, I mean, I would doubt very much as well. Yeah. So they're in favor of German capital. How much Domovina is that? I mean, and so far, I think one has to really to try to shift as well what is discussed. And they usually want only primarily to discuss one subject. And that is the subject they are scandalizing to some extent as well. And in so far, I would saying it is not that you can be silent on the subject, but it is not the only subject you should discuss with them, because then, I mean, you are discussing their subject and not your own. And that is really bad. And that is really bad.
I was earlier thinking about your point with changing tactics towards, for example, showing what interests there really formulate, or which interest they act, but actually this is a tactic already we are already pursuing since several years, and from this I'm not quite clear on this, but from this I have I got the interpretation people either don't want to know or they except to vote against their own interests just in order to vote protest. On the other hand, this protest election is a difficult concept too, but we don't have to forget that we do have a representational crisis as well, yeah, which we can't deny just simply. It's really not like, people voting them for their social or anti-social or whatever program, but they're voting them for
There is an identitarian offer. There is the showing that the anti-establishment sentiment. And apart from that, the party's representation in the in the parliament is only the expression of a social phenomenon. Yeah? There are more than 13% in Germany. There are probably like 20-30% in Germany who rapidly would expulse every migrant out of the country. There are 20% of the Germans who are quite clear anti-Semites, and so on. So this party just represents something social, and on this we have to work. Yeah? And when I say not talk with them, yeah, I'm actually saying, yeah, not talking with them institutionally and with their functionaries and so on. But yeah, we have to discuss on every Stammtisch. What's Stammtisch? In every bar, in every sports association, sport club, whatever, we have to discuss politically, because there we meet the people who are like thinking in this direction, are ideologically oriented in this direction, and have to be countered. Yeah. So I'm not saying, oh no, I'm not talking anymore to any racists in this world. I would soon not talk with a lot of people anymore. Yeah. And still, I think it'd be a fault not to talk about them anymore. Yeah, it's a part of their success. But as I said, there's just an expression of a social phenomenon. And as soon as we start to, or as soon as we end talking about them, then they are legitimized.
My point is not always to talk about the subject they want to discuss. I mean, that is okay. Something different from discussing about them. Yeah? Okay. I think we have to discuss about them in a different way. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. That's the consensus. This Solomonic solution should suffice for today. But of course, we will continue on the same time in the same place tomorrow. But that is starting again with tomorrow at 11. With Nicholas lectures, and then Irena Page, and then at the same at 5 o'clock again this general discussion session, which will not only encompass everything discussed today, but also of course in addition to tomorrow's lectures, which will be more focused specifically on the Balkans and Croatia and Serbia. Okay, so thank you all for your patience and contribution. See you tomorrow.